Hi, good morning. Thank you so much for this turnout this early in the morning, especially at the far end of the city. We've all had to brave the very infamous Bangalore traffic to be here. My name is Pratul Kalia. I lead engineering in Uncommon Bangalore, and I'm going to be talking about how we do, or how we can do better, more efficient, more effective mobile engineering. Uncommon is a agency that does product design, and we specialize in large scale Android applications, and these are some of the clients that we worked with over the past 4 years of our existence. So if you look at the list, there's actually a whole bunch of them. There's small self-funded startups to non-profits to large corporate conglomerates, and the talk content largely comes from my experiences on working with these companies and how we learned that things that could be done better and things that were definitely amiss across a lot of these spaces. This is not an exhaustive list. This is just the list that I threw up this list based on brands that people would be familiar with. There's a long list and others that we can't really talk about. So let's see. We're going to go through 4 different sections today. First one, where I contrast mobile engineering with web engineering. Specifically web engineering, because largely most of us who moved to mobile engineering from other engineering backgrounds did it from some form of web engineering. And even if we did not move, even if you started off in mobile engineering, you really cannot work with mobile without actually having to interact with the web and having to deal with web services and things like that. There's product design, which does not entirely mean just UI design. I mean everything which means how do you build a cohesive product? What do you, the features that you put in, how do you design them? How do you make them be visual? How do you plan your features and things like that? Then there's the platforms themselves, which is the mobile platforms that we all work with, which is Android, iOS, React Native, PWAs, and all of those things. And then there's culture, which is important. I'd say probably the most important part, because you can't do engineering without actually having a strong engineering culture, and your efficiencies will drop and you will have problems unless you're able to build a strong and foster a strong culture of engineering across your organization. So without any further delay, let's get started. So contrasting with the web, one of the things that most people face when they've move to doing mobile engineering is one of those realizations that dawns on most people, is that there is a significant reduction in speed. And that largely stems from 2 different things. One, that on a mobile device, whether it's Android, iOS, or, I'm going to talk largely native here, the UI is very tightly coupled to the rest of the application, which is that if you're familiar with how a regular website works, you have, over the years, there are significant layers in how a web application works. There is a UI layer, which is largely just HTML and CSS. There is a middle layer, which would do some sort of scripting and things like that. There's a backend layer, and they're all very well defined. On a mobile platform, considering it's something that you hold in your hand, or perhaps hold with both your hands if you're using a tablet, this is something that's very tightly coupled, which brings in a significant delay if you are going to change things on the UI. Now, on the other side of it, changing things to the backend also causes a significant impact to how a mobile application sort of develops over its life cycle. And I have this really weird diagram. I don't know how many people can actually read that, but I'm going to point this out here. So this section is what, say, a regular, let's say, a project that's a web project, a web application that you might be building. This is sort of what it might look like, which is that the trifecta of the product team and the backend team and the front end team are working together somewhat in parallel to build this product that needs to be finished in time. And product sort of starts, so if you're going from here to here, product team starts off in the beginning. There's some design, there's some ideas about what you want the final product to look like. And somewhere along the line, the backend and the front end sort of start parallelly, more or less. And as the product develops, the backend develops and the front end develops. But largely, there is a significant amount of independence when it comes to the web. The same thing, if you follow on the mobile, there is this unexplained gap that I have seen most people get very flummoxed. They don't understand. I don't get it. It's just a shopping app. It's just a list of things that you're buying. How? Why is it taking so much time? Why is it so hard for you to change this grid of things here to a scrollable list of things? And these are, like, this is just one of the questions, but these are questions that repeatedly, time and again, come up, especially as for us in a nascent developing market where more and more organizations are moving from the web to mobile, and still are, in fact. We're very heavily invested in mobile, but there are organizations onboarding every day. This is something that constantly amazes people, that, wow, why does this happen? And apart from largely being the UI and the backend, these changes to these systems later during a product's lifecycle cause a significant impact to how the front end reacts to this. Because unlike a website, if you do actually change, say, the backend, where you are expecting a certain response of a certain type, and you change that at some point without actually telling your front end, an iPhone app or an Android application will just crash. Unlike a website, which will potentially just give a blank screen or might throw a strange error. Users are sort of okay with that, I guess. We've been on the web for a long time. We've been on the web for more than a decade, like it's been 20 years. And we're sort of okay with that, right? We're sort of okay with websites kind of not working. Why isn't it working? F5, refresh this thing. It'll work eventually. Everyone's accustomed to board exam results coming out and things just not working. These are things that people are okay with. On the mobile side of things, these are sort of unacceptable. People just don't understand this. Why would this take so much time? What is it that changes things a lot in when it comes to mobile? And I think it's a sort of a double-edged sword. It is a negative. It's a disadvantage that the UI is so tightly coupled. It's a disadvantage that that the backend can actually cause sort of disaster on your client. But there are advantages to it as well. And as we'll see later on, I'll talk about some of those things as well. No dynamic updates. Ouch. This one continues to hit people, regardless of how much time they spent, including me. I've been doing this for many, many years, and this is something that I wish I had a permanent solution to, but there isn't. And unforeseen delays that are not controlled by us do cause problems where you are already in production and you sort of realize that, whoops, I need to change something, and now it'll take me a 2-week release cycle to sort of push it out, and it'll take another 2 weeks for users to sort of get the update. And half of them might not update, and oh no, what do I do here? This is a huge problem. And this came about because of the closed store model, which is very different from what people expect from the web, where there is no store model. There are no large, gigantic corporations controlling our stores here. We unfortunately have to submit to Apple and Google in this case, and go by what they want. There are programs and there are efforts being done to fix this, largely being React Native, one probably the most popular one. And React Native is a very controversial topic on various ways. I'm not going to talk about why it's better, why it's worse, and things like that. But I will talk about one thing, which is, I think, something that people sort of don't realize. And it's something that we were discussing last week at the open house as well. Which is that React Native adds a maintenance overhead to your system. If you're, regardless of whether you're doing Android or iOS, which means that you're probably dealing with Java/Kotlin or you're dealing with Swift/Objective-C, you are now adding and introducing another framework which is written on a completely different stack and a completely different language, which means that your tech team now needs to be well-versed with the, not only with the idiomatic ways of doing things in that language, whether it's JavaScript or PureScript or ClojureScript or whatever, they also need to know how to do it well. If you had expertise in Java or if you had expertise in Swift, now you need to build expertise in this side. And that is an overhead. That is an overhead to every team. And which is probably the most common sort of excuse I give to people against React Native. Everything else is great. It's a great effort. And I think it is actually important for us to learn a lot of things from what React Native has done. But this is something that one really should keep in mind. Also, I like to say this a lot, but I don't remember where this comes from. But if you give people the ability to ship code all the time, they're going to ship bad code really fast all the time. And you can't help that. That's just human nature. It's not that programmers want to ship bad code. It's just that we're largely just adding bugs to things all the time. That's what we do. We add bugs. Lots of versions. So, I mentioned this a couple of minutes ago, but at any given point in time, because of the closed store model and because of the fact that you cannot really control or ensure that all of your user base is using the latest version, your system will have multiple versions live at any time. This is something that I'm hoping audience here is very well versed with, but this brings in a very tricky point to how do you actually mitigate the risks that come in with this? Because that means that now every time that you have a backend change that needs to be made, you have to now use versioned APIs to get away with things like this. Because you now need to ensure that, okay, these three versions that are kind of make up the 90% of my user base, I have to maintain all three. Maybe you did a game-breaking change somewhere in the middle of those in version 2 of the API. Now you need to, your backend team now has a huge overhead of not only running version 1, but version 2, but version 3 also. Not to mention those last 10% people which might be on version 0.7 alpha 2. And it's always a headache, you know. You might be on a large revenue-generating system. Think about it in terms of a company like Uber, or a company like Gojek, or a company like Flipkart. At that scale where you have millions of concurrent users, millions of daily active users, it's a huge pain. And it's versioned APIs are definitely one of the things that people very strongly use all the time. But it is still something that adds to that time of stretching out how much time it takes to build a mobile system. A remote quick switch is something else that a lot of organizations, especially a lot of large-scale applications, do build in because, not because they want to prevent access to users, prevent access to their systems, but at some point in time, you will realize that I've moved 5 versions ahead at this point, and now I have to maintain this really old part that we've refactored to be something better. I have to maintain this because 4.5% of my users are using this. A system like a remote kill switch where you can effectively force the user, force the application to basically say, sorry, your application is too old, please update to continue. It's kind of a bad thing to sort of lock out a user like that. But then also, at that point, you really have no option because you are now adding technical debt forcibly to your own system and you don't really want to do that. You don't want to be in that situation where you're willingly adding this. And as a disaster control measure and as a way to keep your technical debt in check, that's something that a lot of systems use. Section 2, product design. Consistency is somewhat of an expectation on mobile devices, on Android and on iOS. This is something that that for the longest time on Android especially, used to flummox people a lot. And even inexperienced users, like how people say young users or very old users of previous generation, there is a certain expectation of consistency that people have with the platform. And largely that came about because of the push from our corporate overlords. Because both Google and Apple, Google later than Apple, have significant push and they've really tried to channel and sort of push developers towards understanding that and explaining that it is important to have consistency in UI design that is completely missing from web design. If you look at one website versus the other website, there were trends that came about. In the early 90s, there were all those blink tags and there were marquees everywhere. And then there was a web 2.0 where everything went flat and things like that. And there were all nice geometric lines everywhere. Those are things that happened out of trends. But the way these mobile systems have changed over the past few years, even just in the last 10 years, the iPhone's going to be is 10 years old this year, the amount of changes in UI and the expectations that people have had changed so fast because there is a constant push from a single entity that controls the entire marketplace. And this leads to unintended side effects that us as engineers and builders of things need to understand, like the back button confirmation thing. So many people, I guess this is one of those things that's vestigial from desktop users from the days of the desktop on Windows and on macOS, is that on Android, if you click the back button, there is some of those irritating games and apps will say, press back again to exit. And the Airtel app for one is probably the only one on my phone that I have to use, and is the one that pisses me off every time. Every single time I have to double press the back button, I realize that this, the people who are running the show, they really don't understand how this is supposed to work. On iOS, we have slide to go back, and for the longest time, after this gesture was introduced by Apple, my friends who used to use iOS used to constantly get pissed because they became accustomed to using slide to go back on their phones for very, very quickly, because with the OS update, Apple ensured that all their apps worked with it, but the other apps did not. And then you now have a broken experience where either there is a time delay in people realizing this, or people just never realize this because they're not paying attention because the platform's moving so fast. Low tolerance towards jank. How many of us know what jank is? How many of us deal with jank every day, even now? Okay, is there anyone here who doesn't ever experience jank on their mobile device? Okay, fine. I was hoping that maybe there'd be one person I wanted to ask them what is the secret to do this. But this is, again, something that is very mobile specific and largely not something that we see in other platforms. Quick question. Of the percentage of applications that are downloaded from the App Store or the Play Store, what percentage are apps and what percentage are games? Okay, what percentage of the entire apps downloaded always over the lifetime of the App Store do you think is applications? Who's gonna guess? Do you think 99% is apps? Or not your phone, I mean like worldwide. No, I'm not talking specific. How, take a guess on like 70 to 75% apps and 20 to 25% games. Okay, that's correct. So by Apple's own estimates, about 87% of all apps ever downloaded have been games. And the Play Store, the App Store, unfortunately, eats up reviews of older versions, so we don't really have comprehensive data on reviews. But the Play Store is full of reviews of badly performing games everywhere. And this is not just on... This is not just due to the fact that Android actually has a huge disparity in terms of the devices that it provides, but even on like really well-performing, really modern devices. Like I use a Pixel XL, and pretty much every game in some form will sort of stutter here and there, and that's sort of okay, right? It's sort of okay because I think we've been trained by the PC gaming era and by PlayStations and the Xboxes that games sort of frame. And which is, I think, one of the reasons why gamers, especially ones who are avid, tend to know things like what are frames per second. But on the mobile devices, even in terms of applications, performance becomes really, really important. And people sort of, I think, somewhere they haven't let go of the expectations that they had from the early Nokia and Motorola phones, where if you turn the phone on, it just turned on. And when you said, call Pratul, it just called Pratul. If I use a Moto G or an iPhone 4S or an iPhone 5, if I unlock the screen, there is a significant 2-second delay, and which Apple will nicely animate all the icons from space slowly into the dashboard, trying to fool me into thinking that this is working, everything's working really fine. But there are now efforts like that have come into the mobile space because performance is important, and these devices are constantly battling between how do we ensure we get the maximum battery life, which means that we use the least amount of energy, which means our SoCs must be energy efficient. But users also want really fast devices. These are completely orthogonal to each other. And in fact, they're competing. There's no way you can have both. At least we're proving, but they're still, they are orthogonal to each other. And apart from performance being important, it's also important to have perceived speed and sort of take advantage of it. And this is something that Apple's really good at. And I think Google sort of caught up with it. And I'd say on Android, developers have caught up with it, which is that if things are not always fast, which they aren't, you already know you're probably doing this every day in and day out, you stare at your phones, you're building applications, you know that performance isn't always fast, which means that it becomes important to how do I make the user feel that it's actually working fine? How does my end user, how does he or she not know that this is slow, but it looks all cool? One of the ways people do that, for instance, the lock screen animation that iPhone puts in, is one of those ways. And it's something that is very new to people, especially, I'd say, to folks getting onboarded onto mobile now. It's sort of they realize it when they use their own devices, but they don't realize it when they're building these applications out. So one very large company that we worked with, who I'm not going to name, the senior management at that company was very, very amazed at the fact that it took used to take us some amount of time. By some, I mean 500, I think it was 400 milliseconds to actually start the application. And in those 400 milliseconds, they had to actually see sort of a blank canvas of the application. And it's one of those times when I realized that even though this very same person, I'm sure when they go back home and when they, you know, pick up their iPad or take out their phone to look at Google Maps directions, they crib about the fact that there's jank, but they also want us to put in the same thing here, and they want us to, you know, fool the user into these things. But that's happened, that happens, and those are tricks of the trade. Mobile devices have extremely personal information. I'm going to bring this into product design, because this is part of you designing the product, because it's part of you making a conscious choice as to how the product should be like. And it's important because, especially in today's age, where fundamentalism, unfortunately, is on the rise across the globe and across every facet of our lives, its user privacy is critical. And which means it becomes very important for us as engineers and as product designers to be responsible for how we're using our users' data. And how is it that we're actually building features? And do we really need all of that data that we're collecting? Does my product actually need to collect all of the things that I collect to build a feature? A very famous example of this was given by Jesse Wilson from Square. It's a very common example, but Jesse pointed out in a talk, which is that one of the very common features that most applications these days have is who else in my contacts list is using this application. And the sort of straightforward way, the easy way to do that, or like the very obvious way to do that, is to upload your entire, the user's full contacts list onto your server, and then compare who else on my server has the same phone number in their contact list. Okay, these people must know each other, therefore I can show it, blah, blah, blah. Except now you have a problem on your hands, because now you are storing my entire phone book on your server. Which means tomorrow, if you get broken into, you are responsible for leaking my phone numbers / my friends and my family's personal phone numbers out into the world. Jesse Wilson pointed out that one of the very easy and not so obvious ways to build the same thing would be to use a very fast hashing function on the phone. So instead of you uploading the user's entire contact list and storing the contacts list everywhere, why not just hash the user's phone number using something really fast, like say MD5 or even SHA-1. It doesn't need to be secure, it just needs to be fast. And instead upload the hashes and then compare the hashes. You build the product in the exact same way. And it's still telling the user the exact same thing. But you're not now, you don't at night need to wonder about, am I ensuring that my data centers are storing this information safely or not? And this is important, because there are legal implications to engineering turning a blind eye towards this, as recently pointed out by the Volkswagen diesel cheating case. I don't know how many of you know that. But Volkswagen cheated on their diesel emissions. They specifically designed parts of their engine to cheat and tell the emission testing authority that they were actually emitting less harmful gases than they were actually not. And one of the folks who was actually handed a sentence in this was one of the engineering team leads. And it's sort of telling, because at this point, we're all working with organizations and all of us deal with user data. It is as much of our responsibility as it is of the product's responsibility to build these features well and think of better ways of doing this. Let's come to the platforms themselves. Android and iOS are both very new platforms. They might be a decade old, but if you look at the sort of spectrum of computing itself, they're very, very new. The App Store was launched about 2 years after the iPhone was released, which means that the App Store and the whole app economy, the multi-billion dollar app economy, which is why we're all here, is not even 10 years old. They're also controlled by secretive corporate giants who don't always like to tell us the full story, which means that you never really know as to what new decision they might take tomorrow, which might impact the way your app works or your system works. And these platforms haven't had time to mature entirely, because we are still learning, right? We're still learning how do I build this app in the best way for Android. And it's not just us who are learning. It's also Google and Apple that they're learning. And it's not uncommon for us to come across issues in the framework itself, or like bugs in the framework, and realize that, oh, you know, something might got messed up by at Apple and Google's end. Which means that it is sort of a, it makes it hard for us as engineers to build things really well. Unfortunately, related to this, badly behaved applications don't work on the Play Store / App Store at all. And that's because they themselves penalize us for it. By now, Apple and Google have both gone public on this, that if your app does not perform well, they do rank it lower in terms of search results and stuff. Not to mention, your users will be really pissed, and they don't, like, no one likes a badly performing application. The platform itself has significant memory and processor constraints, which means that you need to be extremely cautious with how you use memory, which means you need to be very certain that everything that you're doing, all that processing that you're doing, you really need to do it, and that you need to do it at the time that you're doing it. And if not, it might make some sense to batch it up for doing for it happening later. Disk crashing is something that also happens on mobile devices. I have a very interesting story for this. One of our recent clients realized that their lower-end devices used to crawl on performance, especially after about half a day's usage on their application. And it took us some amount of debugging to realize that that was happening because they were storing a ton of data in their shared preferences. Everyone familiar with shared preferences here? Yes, okay. If not, shared preferences is essentially a way to store key value pairs on Android. Just small yes, no, flags, strings, and stuff like that. They were constantly writing things to shared preferences. I think we measured their shared preference files in total to be about 10 megabytes, which is a lot. These are key value pairs in XML. You can imagine, we're talking about thousands of key value pairs here. And because they would constantly write to shared preferences, and because shared preferences is not a database, shared preferences is just a file that is backed by XML, which means if you think about it, let's say that I have a 1,000-line long XML file and I change one thing here in the middle, which to me as the developer is just a simple API where I just go and say, please change the value of this key to this. Internally, however, for Android, because it's a flat file, they have to go and Android has to go and write the entire file again. And that actually led to this particular application constantly writing to disk, and that it was so significant, it happened so many times that every single UI operation that the user was doing, it significantly slowed down. And this is one of those things where they never would have imagined that just because aggressively storing all the user's preferences and aggressively trying to map user behavior caused a significant performance impact to their platform. Which brings into my next point, which is that because these platforms are so new, it's extremely important for us to realize that there's constant learning required. In fact, it's imperative. You cannot get by being in the mobile space without actually constantly learning what is it that's coming about that's new in the system. Is Apple giving us a better way to do the same thing? Can I do the same thing differently or with less permissions or with better privacy implications on a newer version of Android? In the previous talk, someone mentioned that Android O actually has significant limits on how foreground services can actually function, and that's correct. These platforms are constantly evolving and they're constantly adding new things, which means that it's up to us to educate ourselves and understand how can I build the same product better. I'm going to quote a few examples here. Play Services, which used to be a huge binary behemoth, was split up and split up into various different chunks. I think there are now 18 different chunks of Play Services, from auths to maps to games to things like that, Google Plus and stuff like that. But before that, every application that was using, even if you're using just maps, you had to actually use all of Play Services. But if you were careful and if you read the news and followed your developer updates, you'd know this. Recycler View Prefetch, this is something that Android automatically added to update to App Compat. I think this is 25.1, where the recycler view, especially when you're flinging or when you're scrolling through a long list of items, if you update your App Compat libraries to something higher than 25.1, you automatically get prefetch on devices that have a render thread. So that's Lollipop and above. And this happens completely automatically. All you need to know is to know that what is actually happening. You need to actually just understand. Android O is coming about with a read SMS API, which is, I think it's a great idea, in fact, because at this point, I think no application requests the read SMS permission unless they want to only read it. That's pretty much what all applications do. They read some sort of SMS OTP. And Android O is actually coming out with a way to do this without actually getting access to the user's full SMS database, which means I as a user don't have to worry about what you're going to do with my SMSs, and you as a user, you as a developer don't need to worry about what the user will think when you're accessing all this data. Now, because these platforms are new, and because things are so, constantly in flux and things are always happening, and because performance gets impacted with small things, right? Like below 20%, most mobile devices, both Android and iOS, at below 20% battery, will start to significantly throttle the SoC, which means that they will try to optimize. Which means that you will try to have to optimize your application to work with this. One of the ways people do this is splash screen delays, which is not really optimization, it's fake optimization. Please stop doing that. Please don't add a 2-second delay to your splash screen, because you know that you are starting this huge library on the main thread and you don't want to spend the effort of doing that. Protocol buffers and JSON, one of those things that I've heard enough number of times, where people say that, oh, we have a lot of data running through our network, let's just move all of our JSON to protocol buffers and everything's fine. It's not. In fact, protocol buffers and gzipped JSON data is comparable in size. There is no reduction in size, like minuscule reduction in size when it comes to moving from gzipped JSON to protocol buffers. What is good about protocol buffers is different things. Like, for example, versioning built into the spec itself, and I think more data types. That's something that a more advantage. But don't. Please stop doing optimizations on your applications by following sort of popular legends and without actually verifying if you need this or not. Security theater is an actual concern. Again, blindly following the herd sort of a thing that happens, especially on mobile devices. People assume that if you pin an SSL certificate, nobody will be able to steal your REST API, and that's that, which is absolutely false. Certificate pinning is not a solution to protect your REST API. Certificate pinning is to ensure that no one else is snooping between me, the user, and you, the backend. I don't want someone else to be snooping between, you know, my user and my backend and trying to steal my user's data. Which brings to my second point, which is you should not do client-side encryption. Again, many people, many agencies, many organizations and apps I know that do this. One of the other large-scale organizations that we work with that you know of do this really cool thing where they have to send the user's IMEI to the server. So instead, they have a 120-line-long class file which uses AES encryption to encrypt the IMEI on the device before sending it over a completely secure SSL connection. And that's obviously useless because the connection's already secure. And I actually had to ask the security team as to why they were doing it, and their answer to that was it's more secure. And you know that at that point there is no debate happening because they don't understand security. Which brings me to my last section, which is culture. This slide is my favorite slide in the entire presentation. And a very smart person said this, that you cannot fix with technology what is broken by culture. That's what person being me. And I've said this repeatedly to people, and I'm very proud of having come up with it all by myself. And I've realized the solution to most problems that people come to us with, which is that, oh, we have a problem with this, XYZ. Oh, no, the problem that you have is not with technology. The problem that you have is with culture. Is it the fact that you don't have an engineering culture? You're not encouraging an engineering culture. You're not actually helping your developers be better. We have a problem because our release cycles are all stretched and slow. Oh, no, that's because you're not realizing that your team is burning out because you're making them work Saturdays and Sundays. Oh, but we're a startup. No. That doesn't help at all. You cannot ensure that you do great engineering by destroying your employees or your folks' lives. We'll quickly go through this. Unfortunately, I have very little time. Git is not Dropbox. I think I wish I did not have to put this slide here because I've been using Git for about a decade now. But there are three things that people still, I realize, largely don't use with Git. One, rollbacks. Sad, but the number of people and the number of organizations and teams, very efficient teams otherwise, when they had to roll back a feature, they'd just go and ask a developer that, hey, after lunch, can you spend half an hour removing this code and committing it back again? That doesn't help anyone. Git already solved that problem for you. You can just, you know, the fact that the developer might just introduce another issue while doing that change is a secondary problem. But Git already solved this for you. Bisecting. No one seems to be using this. How many of us here have actually used Git bisecting? Thanks. I'm glad. I'm very happy. Rest of you, please go back and look at bisect. Git has a great way to figure out what part of the, what offending commit actually introduced a bug. It doesn't always help to fix a bug. It helps to also know why the bug came about in the first place. Hooks. Git ties in really well with automation. And Git allows, Git has a very, very nice way of letting you do things when other things are happening in Git. So I want to check that my developer writes the commit message in a certain way. You can add a pre-commit hook, add a shell script to check that. I want to ensure that before a pull request is received, I want to run my test suite, blah, blah, blah. There's another hook for that. Go ahead, look at that. What is your bus factor? How many of us know what bus factor is? Yay. I'm glad. All these old people. So, bus factor came about, I think it came about from due to the Linux community, from the kernel community, where essentially what bus factor means is that how many people in your team need to get hit by a bus before your project derails. And which means that your bus factor must be really high. Which means that it one person should, you should not have, like, in a team of 13 people, there should not be one person who is largely the only person who knows what's actually happening, and the rest 12 sort of just run around this one person and try to figure out, you have to do this. Oh, I'm trying to do this, but no, you have to actually do that. You don't want that situation where that one person is it. And there are three ways you solve this. First is documentation, which is that you document your system and you document your processes. The second is documentation, which is that should ensure that, you know, these things are written down. The third is documentation, which is that your developers, your product team, your designers, your, if your organization has a certain process, which I'm hoping it does, this should be documented somewhere. If I'm joining your team tomorrow, it should be very obvious to me, what is it that I need to do to get started? Here's your laptop, here is your access card, everything else is listed here. This is how you connect to the Git repository, this is how you check out the code, this is the initial, this is the sort of low level bugs that you can automatically attack. This is where our sprint planning happens. All of this should be documented. This should be present somewhere in a document. It shouldn't be a person's responsibility. It's really hard finding great people to work with. I'm sure everyone will agree with that. And if you're going to take that one person's job for 2 days away and teach this new person that, you know, here, tell this person how, what it takes to be part of our company, that's already a problem. Are you measuring the metrics? Data-driven design is extremely popular these days. Data-driven development is very popular these days. Interesting story again. A large corporate that we are very familiar with likes to really, really catch all sorts of data that their users are producing, generating. And at the last count when we were working with them, they had 6 different data collecting libraries in their application, which caused a huge performance impact, obviously. If you're going to throw in New Relic and Localytics and Mixpanel and Crashlytics and everything else, Bugsnag, this and that, if you're actually going to throw in all those things, apart from the fact that you should be really, really certain that you're actually using those libraries, you're also significantly impacting performance. And that's actually a problem. And it's exactly what we solved there. We shaved off 2.5 seconds from their startup to final whatever thing that they were doing, time, by 2.5 seconds by just removing and consolidating their analytics libraries. That was it. That's all we did. They were really happy that we did that, but it did not take a lot of, it doesn't take a lot of effort to sort of realize that if you're going to throw in all of these things, it doesn't automatically work. New Relic doesn't automatically tell you why your activity is slow. It has to monitor those things. Everything it's monitoring, it will have to, somewhere it's going to have an impact. Effort does not mean progress. This might, again, kind of obvious, but the number of folks that we've worked with, who, when teams we've worked with, who will tell us and say, oh no, we actually need 50 developers. We need 50 people because they have a lot of work. And they're all busy, always. See, like, you can see it. Cubicles full of 50 people working on the same Android application. That doesn't mean anything. That just means they're putting in effort. I could ask all of us right now to go and push that wall, and we could all be doing a lot of work and we'll all sweat. But the wall is not going to come down, hopefully. It's not going to come down. You can't just keep doing effort without actually measuring that are you actually moving forward. One of the ways that we do this is for a team that we work with, go and see what your bug fix to feature ratio is. That in a sprint cycle, whether it's a week or 2 weeks or whatever, is your team actually working on 50 bug fixes and 3 sort of features? Is it like, oh, you know, 20% bug fixes, 80% new things? It's like a good ratio. But if you just measure this, if you look at the effort that your team is putting in and you realize that, you know, this is something that's not good, you can actually work towards fixing it. And two very important books were written very, very long ago, before I was born, which I will highly recommend. The first one being The Mythical Man Month by Fred Brooks. Kind of a controversial book because it's kind of sexist, but please read it. The second being Peopleware, which talks about productive teams and how literally just what I said, which is that you cannot really solve things by engineering what is broken by culture. That's it. Thank you very much. That's the end of this slide. Questions? I don't think we have time.
We have 2 minutes for questions.
Okay, 2 minutes. Questions?
I'm glad
everyone understood everything.
If you think of some questions later, Pratul will be back on stage at 2 o'clock as part of our off-the-record session on scaling challenges. Slightly different topic, but I'm sure he'd still entertain the questions.
Thanks everyone.
Thank you very much.